With this year's midterm elections just 2 days away, many political junkies and bystanders alike will be consulting the political news website 538. Named for the number of votes in the Electoral College, 538 uses national and local polls, as well as historical voting patterns, to create an election forecast model that is perhaps the most closely watched in the country. Their most recent forecast shows a 6-in-7 chance that Democrats will win the House and similar odds that Republicans will hold control of the Senate. This week, PBS NewsHour Weekend's Christopher Booker sat in on a taping of 538's podcast and discussed with founder Nate Silver and his colleagues how they cover today's news and political landscape.
Hello and welcome to the 538 Politics Podcast. My name is Jody Avergan. We are 8 days away from Election Day and the events.
As he has done so many times before, host Jody Avergan has assembled the 538 Politics Podcast team to talk about the upcoming election.
I think everyone knows this happens, which is that people call up reporters and they say, this is why we're going to win, or this is why the state is looking rosy.
In a crowded field of over 500,000 available podcasts, the show has emerged as a must-listen, ranking among the top 150 podcasts on iTunes.
The midterm elections are really important. It's the country's first major chance to say how it feels about everything that's happening. I mean, look,
538's forecast model burst onto the political scene during the 2008 presidential election, when founder Nate Silver calculated the results of the popular vote within one percentage point. In 2012, he got it right again, this time correctly identifying the winner in all 50 states. But 2016 was a bit different. 538's forecast model sat well outside much of the popular narrative. Reuters had given Hillary Clinton a 90% chance of winning. The New York Times model gave her an 85% chance of winning, while 538 only gave her a 71% chance.
There was criticism before the election that you had probability of a Trump victory around 30%. It was amongst the highest of the forecasts. And then there was criticism afterward that you didn't have the probability correct.
Yeah.
Did 2016 change the way you model probability?
No, because we think our forecast was right, that very few people thought it was a competitive election. If you looked at the data carefully and built a good model of it, you would have known that Trump winning was not that big a surprise.
While they haven't changed their model, they have changed the way they describe their forecasts, emphasizing 538 trades in probability, not prediction.
We've thought about people's misinterpretations, and I think everyone, all news consumers, are getting smarter. Now we do it in, this person has a 1-in-6 chance of winning. So it's more the vernacular of when we talk about, in everyday life, when we talk about gambling or chance, we usually do, 1 in whatever the number is.
Silver says this clarifies what the forecast is indicating for the audience.
Well, first of all, people don't confuse it as much, because I think 20% means, Trump's only got 20% of the vote, right? Instead of having a 20% or 30% in our model chance, it forces them to think about what it actually means, right? But if we have a model that gives Democrats, for example, a 1-in-6 now chance of winning the Senate, right? That's not just meant to hedge our bets. We're saying that given the uncertainty in polling, that if you have this election 6 times under similar circumstances, 1 out of 6 times, they would wind up winning.
I wonder if it's worth just parsing out.
According to Silver, the podcast gives the team a wider avenue to explain the complicated methodologies that drive 538's forecast models.
I think it's a way to make content that's pretty technical and pretty dense more accessible to people. It's a way to let people kind of see our thought process.
This is what is so tricky about covering politics. Getting the facts right is hard enough, but what are you putting emphasis on? What are you spending the majority of your time talking about?
I think it's good for journalism to level with the reader or the listener or the viewer and say, hey, here's what we know, here's what we don't know, here's how we're thinking about it. I think that helps, and I think that builds trust.
I thought it could be helpful for readers to kind of see right next to each other Republican spin and Democratic spin on the Senate map, which we are currently giving Republicans a better chance to control the Senate.
It's a huge advantage of having the model, is the model keeps us in check. It forces you to take a step back and take a long view, calm down. You know, it's very easy in the news cycle to get wrapped up in things.
I remember being pretty shocked by that and thinking that crossed the line, and also thinking at the time that the way the media covered the story was inappropriate, right? A big part of what 538 does, a big kind of core part of what we're known for is debunking media narratives that are overblown or overdramatic or overwrought, or whether it's groupthink around something. And typically, like in an election campaign, that gets worse and worse and worse. You know, so it's like things that like would make like a 1 point difference in our model, people will talk about them like it's a 5 point dramatic swing. And so it's always like a little bit more even keeled, I think.
There are so many news events that go down the memory hole. I mean, like, who's talking about Brett Kavanaugh this week?
Is there one specific thing you can cite that you would change for the way media covers politics?
Just one? I would have the media be smarter about selecting what tool in its journalistic toolkit it's using to answer what question. So in other words, the question of who's going to win the House is really a question that's best answered with data. That's just empirically true. Looking at the polls, fundraising, doing all that in a smart, systematic way is better at answering that question than going to Allentown, Pennsylvania, and talking to six people. Now, that data is not a good tool to answer other questions. You know, what will Trump do on healthcare if he wins a second term? You know, you can't use data to answer that question.
The narrative of 2018 is that we are a divided nation. Is this reflected in the data?
Yes.
Yes.
For sure. Although less in some ways than in other elections where, you know, we have in our forecast 110 or something congressional districts where we think either party could win. There are 10 or 12 Senate races that either party could win out of 35. The times when I'll really start to buy into critics of what's happening to American democracy will be when people give up and aren't turning out to vote. So I think there's a lot of, and this is a very 538 thing, right? Like, America's as divided as ever is like mostly true, but I think we kind of instantly are looking for like the ways in which it might be slightly not true or might be a little bit exaggerated as a narrative.
It's pretty true though.
Yeah.